So now, really quickly, just want to make a key for these practice questions. I've been doing them kind of individually, but this is just going to be one quick, like, boom, boom, boom through the whole video or through the whole key. So yeah, let's do it. Let's dive right in. Let's see what we got. Okay, so we're looking at number one. A ball is dropped from rest and falls to the floor. The initial gravitational potential energy of the ball-Earth-floor system is 10 joules. The ball then bounces back up to a height where the gravitational potential energy is 7 joules. What was the mechanical energy of the Earth ball floor system the instant the ball left the floor? So we kind of have these two processes, and we want to know, okay, it's on the floor, and then it bounces back up. So during this motion of being on the floor to being back up, nothing's going to change the energy from when it's down here to when it's back up to its new tallest point where it has 7 joules of potential energy. There's no friction, there's not any air friction, there's no drag. So we're going to say that energy is conserved from this point to that point. So we can kind of make our little LOL diagram if we want. So we can say, okay, at this very bottom point, we have it's moving, right? It bounces and it has this kinetic energy, so it has this kinetic energy. And then the very top point, all it has is gravitational potential energy. We go from kinetic to gravitational. They tell us we have 7 of gravitational, which means that we have 7 joules of kinetic energy. Another way to think about that is kind of the way that I prefer, not like prefer you do, but the way that I prefer, is thinking about kind of what happens, calling this position A. And this as position B. So we're saying at A, if we look at it, we have some gravitational potential energy. Let's define our system actually with the ball, Earth, and let's put the floor in our system. Why not? All right, so here we have 10 joules of potential energy. Here we have 7 joules of potential energy, which means that a little bit of energy, oops, sorry, actually. So it bounces. And the floor is going to heat up a little bit. We have this interaction, so we have this thermal energy, say 3 joules of thermal energy. So if we look at it, we go, okay, we got 10 joules, that's equal 7 from our potential energy at B plus our thermal energy. So if we're looking at this, well, we said that our mechanical energy is made up of our potential energy and our kinetic energy. This thermal energy is not mechanical energy because we can't really get it back. We can't use it. We can't harness that thermal energy. That's just kind of this random heating up of our particles. We can't use it. This potential and this kinetic we can use, but the thermal we can't use. Thermal's not part of our mechanical energy. Mechanical energy is just potential and kinetic. So here we have 10 of potential and then 7 of potential because 3 of it is going to be thermal. That's supposed to be a T, thermal. Okay, on to the next one. A rubber ball with mass of 0.20 kilograms is dropped vertically from a height of 1.5 meters above the floor. The ball bounces off of the floor, and during the bounce, 0.6 joules of energy is dissipated. What is the maximum height of the ball after the bounce? All right, so let's do it. Let's make an LOL diagram. Let's think about it. So our system is going to be made up of the ball and the Earth. And that's kind of it. At this point A, we say, well, our ball is at some height above the ground, so we know we have gravitational potential energy. And then we're saying it's not doesn't have anything else going on, so we just have gravitational potential energy. At this point B, again, it just has gravitational potential energy. But it tells us that some of our energy is dissipated. Some of our energy leaves our system. So we can set this up and say our potential energy at A is equal to our potential energy at B plus some work, some of the energy that left our system. So yeah, let's set this up. We can say our equation for potential energy is mgy. So we have mgya is equal to mgyb. Plus the work we said was 0.6 joules. So we said the mass was 0.2 kilograms, g, let's just call it 10, y was 1.5. And we want to solve for this yb. Alright, and now we can go ahead and do some math. And I'm just calling G10 because I don't want to deal with gross numbers. So we have 3. Oh, I should have been able to do that. That's 2 times YB plus 0.6. So that's 3 minus 0.6 is 2.4 is equal to 2 times YB. YB is equal to, looks like 0.8333 meters. Wait, no. 1.2 meters. I know how math works. Yeah, 2.4 divided by 2. Alright, so we got 1.2 meters. Cool. Alright, so the next one. A student uses a spring scale to exert a horizontal force on a block, pulling the block over a smooth floor. The student repeats the procedure several times, each time pulling the block from rest through a distance of 1 meter. Which of the following graphs of force is a function of distance? Will the block be moving the fastest at the end of the 1.0 meters? So if we look at this situation, we'd say, okay, we have the block's not moving, and then we have the block, it is moving, and it has some sort of external force applied to it. So if we look at this LOL diagram, we'd say, okay, well, it's not moving at first, so it has no energy. We're doing work on our block for the system, and it ends up with some sort of kinetic energy. So we're saying, well, the amount of work that we're done is equal to our kinetic energy. And our kinetic energy is equal to 1/2 mv squared. So we're really saying our work is equal to our 1/2 mv squared. So the more work we have, the more velocity we'll have, the faster it'll be moving, which is what our question's asking. Then the final thing we have to look at is, how can we figure out how much work is done from a force versus distance graph? Well, the area under a force versus distance graph is going to tell us the amount of work. So the area is going to equal the work. So we just have to pretty much find which one has the most area, which one has the most work done. This one has 2 boxes, this one has 3 boxes, this one has 2 boxes, and this one has 2.5 boxes. So it looks like B is going to have the most work done because it has the greatest area with 3 of those boxes. Alright, the graph below represents the potential energy U as a function of displacement x for an object on the end of a spring oscillating in simple harmonic motion with amplitude x0. Which of the following graphs represents the kinetic energy of the object as a function of displacement x? So we really just have this block on this spring, and it just kind of is oscillating or moving backwards and forwards. So it looks kind of weird, but it's moving this way, then that way, this way, then that way, this way and that way, back and forth. So if we're kind of looking at this exchange, if we look at kind of the maximum positions, the block, spring, earth, floor. And so if we look at this, let's just kind of pick 2 points. Let's pick the maximum stretch. And then a spot where we have 0 stretch, where we're at our equilibrium. Moving that way. So we go from having all spring potential energy to all kinetic energy. So really our spring is equal to our kinetic at these maximums. And then we kind of pick another point. Then we kind of have this trade-off where our spring potential energy plus our kinetic has to equal our spring potential energy plus our kinetic. I'm just kind of picking random points, but really the main idea is that within this, the total energy is our spring potential energy plus our kinetic energy. So we have to make sure that this total stays constant. So we have the same, that was not a good one. So we have the same, this is my graph, this is total energy. We have to make sure that stays the same. So let's just kind of pick this point. If we have 0 here, we have to have our kinetic be a maximum. We have maximum spring over here. We have to have these be equal to 0 for our kinetic. And then we really just have to do whatever we can to make sure that the total is always the same. So it's going to be like the inverse, so that every point we look at it, we can add these and find that our total is still the same. We still have the same total amount of energy within our system. So this is really a graph of just conservation of energy. So answer is D. That'll fulfill our conservation of energy so that at every point, our total energy is constant. A block of mass 3 kilograms slides along a horizontal surface that has negligible friction except for one section, as shown below. The block arrives at the rough section with a speed of 5 meters per second and leaves it 0.5 seconds later with a speed of 3 meters per second. What is the magnitude of the average frictional force exerted on the block by the rough section of the surface? Alright, let's do this. So first, let's kind of make an LOL diagram and say that our system is made up of the block and the Earth. So let's say that the track is outside of our system. Okay, so block and Earth are part of our system. And let's look at it. So at the beginning point, if we look at it, it's moving, so it has kinetic energy. And that's kind of it. We don't have any other kinds of energy that we care about. And if we look at this position, let's call this B. Our block is still moving, but it has less kinetic energy because it's moving slower. And yeah, so some of this energy had to go somewhere. They're saying that this is rough, which means that there's friction, which means that some energy left our system due to work. This frictional force did work on our system. Worthless. All right, so let's first figure out how much work was done. We want to know the frictional force. Oh, it's kind of weird. Yeah, it'll be fine. Alright, so we want to know this work so we can find the frictional force. So let's figure out the work first. Let's say this is equal to 1 half mva squared plus 1 half mvb squared. Okay, so then what we can say is our mass is 3 kilograms. And our initial velocity at A was 5. One half. Okay, so we can solve and say the amount of work is 0.5 times 3 times minus. Our work is going to be 24 joules, it looks like. The work done is 24 joules, and we know a couple things about work. We know that work is equal to our force times our displacement. So our work, in this case our 24 joules, is equal to the force that's causing the change in energy, in this case it's a frictional force, over the displacement of the rough section. So the problem is we don't know the displacement. We don't know how much distance this rough section is. So what we care about is the average frictional force, and we know a few things about the motion of our object. We know the initial velocity, we know the final velocity, and we know how much time that takes. So what we can do is kind of use our kinematics. We know that we have this equation that tells us x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1 half at squared. And we also have this equation that says v is equal to v naught plus 8 times t. So if we were looking at this equation, it would tell us how much displacement our rough section is, but we don't know the acceleration. So we first have to figure out the acceleration of our object. So let's figure this out. We said that the final is 3, the initial was 5 meters per second acceleration, and the time is what, 0.2 seconds? 0.5 seconds. Negative 2 equals 0.5a. 2 divided by 0.5 is 4, right? Yay. So the acceleration is negative 4 meters per second squared. We can then plug into this and say x is equal to v naught was 5 times 0.5 plus 1 half negative 4.5 squared. So x is equal to 2.5 plus 4. x is equal to 2 meters. I believe if I did my calculations correctly. Yeah. Alright, so x is 2 meters, which is our displacement. And so 24 is equal to our frictional force times 2. So our frictional force has to be 12 newtons. Okay, and that's those questions.